डिस्क्राइब कॉमन साउंड्स
पहला वाला फैक्टर
कैन बी हैव अदर साउंड्स म्यूटेड प्लीज Then Johnson in 1998 introduced the term gene, and he said gene is control character. Garrod in 1909, in a very, very far-sighted book, Inborn Errors of Metabolism, there he talked about that genes control metabolism. This was a very important concept that, that happened about genes. Then Morgan from 1910 onwards described gene, characterized its as unit of function, mutation, and recombination. See, Morgan's legacy is remarkable. In fact, today, all the geneticists across the world, molecular biologists, most of them can trace their academic lineage to Morgan. That has been the great impact that Morgan had on the field of genetics, on what genes do, how they are. Then Biddle and Tatum in 1942, using Neurospora, showed that genes control synthesis of one enzyme. McClintock in 1940s talked that genes can transport, although she was not understood in 1940s. But then in 1970s, it became clear that yeah, transposable elements are very important. Avery et al. In 1944 established that DNA has a transcriptomic activity, and that provided some chemical basis to talk about this enigmatic feature of biology, that gene, what it was. Now at least one could think in terms of material sense that it is something to do with the chemical that we name as DNA. And then Watson and Crick in 1953 described the DNA double helical structure, which opened in a completely new era in understanding how genes work and what genes are. Crick presented what we know as central dogma, that gene is a length of DNA that is transcribed to RNA, which is transmitted protein. At that time, it was a speculative idea, but then this central dogma opened up numerous experiments, and that's where we learned what we have learned today. Ingram in 1956, working on the hemoglobinopathies, particularly the sickle cell anemia, showed that genes control synthesis of one polypeptide. So from one gene, one protein, or one gene, one enzyme, now it was gene, one gene to one polypeptide. Benzer in 1957 established for the first time that gene is divisible into cistron, neutron, and recon. I'll talk about each of these in some detail later on. Jacquard and Monod in 1961 introduced the terms operator, promoter, and structural genes. That is, depending on their functional properties, they were classified. Thomas in 1971 raised this issue of C-value paradox, that why do we have so much of DNA in our genome, and why doesn't it correlate with the biological complex in the organism, which remains a challenging issue even today. Then around 1960s and onwards, repetitive DNA sequences discovered, stratified DNA, repetitive DNA, and that added to the puzzle of what genes are. Then in 1980 came the concept that there is a lot of selfish or junk DNA. And then from 1970 onwards, we had all kinds of definition of genes. They can be split, they can be overlapping, they can be included, they can be scrambled, they can be non-coding, and so on. So now let's look at this, the historical one by one. Mendel's factor, when he talked about the laws of dominance, laws of segregation, laws of independent assortment, based on the seven pairs of contrasting characters that he chose in P, he came up with these ideas. And that was one of the early establishment. Unfortunately, it was far ahead of his time. Mendel himself had no idea of mitosis or meiosis. Nobody knew what mitosis, meiosis, till several years later. So Mendel couldn't be understood. But then in 1900, his laws were rediscovered and established. And then in the 1902, two independent scientists, Walter Sutton, actually a surgeon who developed the surgery of appendicitis, and Theodore Bovary, an experimental embryologist, independently came to the conclusion that what happened during meiosis is exactly what will explain Mendel's laws of segregation and independent assortment. Because at metaphase one, how the pairs organize on the spindle will decide independent assortment. That set the stage for independent assortment. Then finally, their movement at anaphase one, when the homologs move to opposite poles, is what one would call a segregation. And so this was a major development in the history of genetics. that now we knew physically where genes are located, that they are located on the chromosomes. Then in the early history part, Johansson coined the term genes, phenotype and genotype, which was very important point to understand that there is a genotype and there's a phenotype relationship. Archibald Garrard wrote this book involved as a metabolist and suggested that genes control metabolism. And then in Morgan in 1999, he started using the soft leather method. He was an experimental embryologist, but then moved to genetics and established the what we still call as the fly room at Columbia University, where he started his work. He and his group established the basic features of gene during next 2-3 decades. And this had the very far-reaching implications even today, what Morgan's group established about genes. And gene mapping started using Drosophila, and this was a very remarkable, rapid work that the first mutant in Drosophila was discovered by Morgan in 1909, the white eye. But then within a few years, without having, without knowing how to induce mutation, they just collected spontaneous mutations in nature or in laboratory and started mapping them with the Sturtevant, Altenburg, Brizes, and Muller, these five in the group with Morgan. They established very quickly that genes are organized in linkage maps as a linear order. And very soon in Morgan's lab, again, T.S. Pinter, who understood the polytrin chromosome, which are one of the best models for studying gene function and so on. And Bridges made this drawing of polytrin chromosome, hand drawing. This, of course, a photograph that has been prepared later on, that each chromosome had many, many chromomeres or bands and interbands. And what could be established in Morgan's lab was that specific genes that were mapped on the linkage map were associated with specific bands. So now there's a complete collinearity between what we see the chromosome organization and the genetic map. So now the genes were not just hypothetical entities, but something physically present on the chromosome. This was an important point that happened in the 1930s. And then what, so to summarize what we learned from Morgan studies between 1910 to 1910 onwards, that it was believed that gene is a locus or a point on a linear chromosome. Now that's why we call point mutation. That's why we say that this gene occupies this locus. It's a defined physical space on the hypothetical line that the linkage map is presented as. And what was defined at that time, the concept that developed it, according to at that time's study was a gene occupying a specific locus is unit of function, that means it controls a phenotype, it's unit of mutation, that's how new alleles are generated, and it's a unit of recombination through crossing over between genes. Now, this led to several questions even in the 1930s, that does gene control only one phenotype? It when a gene mutates, is the whole gene mutating or a part of it is mutating? When recombination happens, does it happen only between genes or within a gene it can happen? And in fact, in 1930s, several people working with Drosophila raised this question that maybe there are subunits of the gene that can mutate or recombine independently, but it was not possible to come to a definitive conclusion on this, because of the limited number of studies that could be done using Drosophila. Then in 1942, Biddle and Tatum working with Neurospora, see the reason why they changed from Drosophila, Biddle was a Drosophila worker, but he moved from Drosophila to Neurospora because Drosophila has a complex organization and its intake, nutrition intake was very complicated. We didn't know what all chemicals it needs. And so they started using Neurospora crassa, a fungus which can be cultured in a simple medium containing glucose and some nitrate salts, so that it's very convenient to discover mutant that affects the nutrition requirements. And that's where they did mutagenize Neurospora, grew them on complete medium and minimal medium. The ones that did not grow in minimal medium, then they grew on supplemented medium and then found that, for example, something that can grow in complete medium but not in minimal medium, if you provide arginine, it can grow. So the conclusion was that this must have a mutation in the gene that affects arginine biosynthesis. And that's how, by doing this, they came to one gene, one enzyme hypothesis, that each gene controls synthesis of an enzyme. Around that time, Barbara McClintock, who has been working with maize genetic cytology and so on, discovered a very peculiar phenomenon that the kernel phenotype, that means the color of the seeds on a maize corn, can vary generation to generation. And even if she did complex, very fine genetics, the next generation, what kind of pattern it will show was variable. And she then came to the conclusion that some genes can jump, they can move. Obviously, 1940s, again, the idea of a gene occupying a defined locus on a chromosome, this could not be understood, this could not be accepted. But then it was only 1960s that in bacteria, they discovered the IS elements, insertion sequence elements, and later on in other eukaryotes, transposed elements were discovered. Then only they could realize that what Barbara McClintock talked in 1940s of jumping genes, the reality. Then in around same time, 1944, Avery McClure McCarthy did this great experiment of transformation on using the extracts from the pneumococcus bacteria, the smooth and rough variety, and could show that DNA had a transformation activity, which triggered studies on DNA itself and culminated in Watson and Crick showing the double helical structure, that DNA had double helical. And an important point in this paper, very short paper, one-page paper, is the last paragraph, where they state that because of double helical structure, they can now imagine how the genetic information can be copied to be passed from the daughter, that means how it could replicate. This was a very important conceptual development. Then two, 3 years later, Crick came out with this idea that how does the information flow from cell within a cell and from generation to generation. And now the idea was that DNA carries the genetic information and this can be passed on, it can copy itself, which was called replication. This DNA can be copied into RNA and that RNA can be translated into protein. He did not use the term translation. Translation term was introduced much later. He even raised the possibility that we can DNA make direct protein. But it was very soon ruled out that this cannot happen. But an important point of the central dogma was that information cannot flow back from protein to RNA or to DNA. And actually, Crick at that time did not even agree that it can flow back from RNA to DNA, although it was discovered later on that there's a reverse transcriptase, and so the information can flow from DNA to RNA, DNA to DNA, DNA to RNA, RNA to RNA, and RNA to DNA. And from RNA to protein, but not in reverse direction. So this was an important point of central dogma, that it was about flow of information from gene to give rise to phenotype. Then Benger did a remarkable study. Interestingly, Benger was not a trained biologist. He was a trained physicist, quantum physicist. But then he moved to biology, started working on bacteriophages. Because again, it's important to appreciate the model system. Drosophila was very convenient, Neurospora was much better, but Benger argued that even Neurospora is complex because there are so many other kinds of molecules. So how we can understand genes, and so he chose, following his mentors, Max Delbruck, to work on bacteriophage because they have just DNA and protein. And DNA was known to have the genetic material and they could multiply in millions in a day. And so one could look at a very rare phenotype. And using R2 locus of T for bacteriophage, which he did remarkable studies, recombination mapping, complementation mapping. And then he came to this idea using cis-trans test. That means two mutants of same gene, either being in cis or in trans configuration, do they have different phenotypes? And based on that, he came to the conclusion that gene can be divisible into cistron, which is unit of function, muton, which is unit of mutation, and recon, which is unit of recombination. From Morbus' definition of gene being unit of function, mutation, recombination, now we realize that there are three different parameters in a gene. Function unit can also be divided. What we think as one gene may have two or more function units. And it can have many, many mutation units, and it can have many units of recombination. Next development, important development around same time was Ingrams and his group studies on sickle cell anemia and other hemoglobinopathies. With sickle cell anemia, particularly, the blood normal RBCs are like this, but people suffering from this inherited disorder have sickle RBCs, and they have lots of problems. What Ingram could show was it was using a very ingenious technique of peptide mapping using chromatography, that one particular peptide only differs, and he sequenced that. Again, please remember, from today's, we have much simpler or much more efficient ways of sequencing amino acids and DNA and so on. But in 1950s, it was one of the most remarkable and most difficult methods, but they used that. And they could. And what Ingram could show was that sickle cell anemia was simply due to one base change, in one of, which results in the replacement of glutamic acid to valine in polypeptide, beta globin, not in alpha hemoglobin. And that's where he said, instead of calling one gene one protein, we should call one gene polypeptide. Then Jacob and Mono came out with the regulation of lactoferrin in E. coli, and they talked about that there are regulatory genes, there are promoter genes, there are operator genes. Now, understand this, regulatory gene produces a product. Promoter and operator sites are genes, what they call as genes, are not making any product. They are simply affecting how the RNA polymerase can bind or cannot bind to transcribe what we call as structural genes. Now, around this time, central dogma began to take much better shape, and people began to talk about it, that yes, we have DNA which can make RNA, and RNA can make DNA back again, and RNA can be transferred on ribosomes. You see, in 1960s, there was a remarkable flurry of activities. Ribosomes were identified, the process of translation was understood, transfer RNAs were understood, and so we now knew that from DNA information flows through RNA to protein, and that proteins control phenotype, which can make a difference between, let's say, a human or a chimpanzee, depending on what kind of proteins we make. This was the view at that time. And at that time, it was believed that RNA is only an intermediate information transfer. Now, this is something that we need to learn, and I think students must understand this. The central dogma was about the direction of information flow. It did not state that RNA cannot have independent functions. However, this became the widespread belief that only DNA has the function, RNA is only an agent for transferring that DNA to protein. But RNA by itself cannot have a function. And this led to some damage to understanding actual gene function. And for several decades, looking at RNA, which are not transferred to cytoplasm, nucleated RNAs, and the heterochromatin, condensed chromatin transcripts that they were making, what they do, people didn't bother about it because they were not making proteins. Another change in the idea of gene was that genes were found to be split, that they had introns between them, studied by Sharp and Roberts to begin with, and later on very quickly confirmed by many others, that the DNA is a long one, but the RNA that comes out, initially it has whole of it, but then a large part of this RNA gets spliced out, and that's where the splicing was discovered. The genes could be split, not a contiguous that makes a protein directly. And then another puzzling thing was, when people start looking at ciliates. Ciliates are interesting for eukaryotes because they show first kind of differentiation of germline and somatic lines. Ciliates are two nuclei, a micronucleus and a macronucleus. The micronucleus is the one with which you take equivalent of germ cells, and macronucleus equivalent of somatic cells, because micronucleus is the one that can undergo meiosis, that can undergo mitosis and produce daughter nuclei. And when it goes to meiosis, it can produce the equivalent of male and female gametes through the process of conjugation. Macronucleus, on the other hand, is passed on to the next generation only through binary fission, where it doesn't divide mitotically but simply elongates and splits into two parts, what we call as mitosis. But subsequently, what it was shown was that formation of macronucleus involves extensive rearrangement of the micronuclear genome, resulting in loss of about 95% DNA that is present in the micronucleus. Only a small amount of DNA is retained, and that is also retained as gene-sized DNA molecule instead of long chromosomal DNA. Now, each gene is a single DNA molecule. And more studies want to show us that, for example, in Oxytricia, actin 1 gene, when one looks at the micronuclear DNA sequence, it has what has been numbered, the 3, 4, 6. These are sequence blocks which are numbered that way. But when one looks at the same DNA in the macronuclear genome, it has the blocks arranged in the same order. Now, this is what we call as the micronuclear gene is scrambled. The term scramble comes from scrambled egg, that you break an egg into pieces and you do not know where is what. But Oxytricia knows where is what piece. And every time it makes a macronuclear, beautifully organize each of these pieces, like it will have to take one, then join two, then join three, four, five, five and six are also reverse order, seven and nine, eight has been brought in here to get the functional actin gene. And this is not true just in the actin 1 gene. Several genes in many celiacs have this kind of organization. We do not know whether many eukaryotes also have, but one equivalent that we have is immunoglobulin genes. Immunoglobulin genes have constant region, the diversity region, the joining region, and so on. But then they are not scrambled like this. They are only rejoined in a random manner to generate the diversity of immunoglobulin that we can make. But that's not scrambling. But as I said, this is a very near example that the genome has a very different organization of the DNA sequence compared to what we get into the RNA ultimately. Then there were more puzzles available, that one locus can make multiple products. How it can make? One is by altered splicing, that some of the introns are removed, some introns may not be removed, and therefore the final product that you get has different amino acid sequences. And this means that same gene can produce more than one kind of polypeptide. One of the largest polypeptide producing gene, I mean, most diverse kinds of, is the gene called D-SCAM in Drosophila, which is expressed in neural cells and has an important function there. It is claimed that this single gene can make about 35,000 to 37,000 polypeptides by using this altered splicing. So this is a remarkable thing, that one gene can now have multiple products. Another way to produce multiple products from same gene is by terminating transcription at different points. Either it can terminate here or it can terminate here, and accordingly, the peptide made from here to here will have some component which is absent in this, which terminates here, and therefore the two peptides will have different function because we get different kinds of mRNAs. Then they can be multiple promoters, so that transcription can start here or can start here, and accordingly we can get different proteins. And sometimes to add to more variables here, when it starts from here, certain regions will have taken as intron in one case can become exon in another case, and vice versa. That's so using intron as exon variability, variability in the termination sequences, variability in the promoter sequences, we can get multiple products from the same gene. But more curious was a case where two or more genes are overlapping. They may have partial overlap or they may have complete overlap. And the overlap may be that the two genes are on opposite strands, so they transcribe in convergent orientation. Or from the same strand, DNA strand, they may transcribe in two opposite strands and they will give us the two products. So they can be partial in the same direction or in opposite direction. Similarly, in complete, one gene is included within another gene. For example, this thin line is the intron of this green gene, and within this intron is another gene which is transcribed in opposite direction. Or they can overlap an intron and exon, both of them. Or they may be overlapping in the same direction or in opposite direction. So this adds to the diversity of the products that we can get from one gene. And this brings us the question, does one locus have one function, as was claimed in Morgan's time or the Biddle and Tatum or Ingram and others, that a locus or a gene makes one function. But now we can see that they can make not only related function, diversity, but completely independent function. For example, this green gene may make one product, but this red gene transcribed from an opposite direction from the intron region, which is not even retained in this green gene protein, this makes a completely different kind of protein. So obviously these genes will have very different functions, and we see this as increasing example in diverse genomes. Then the other issue with genes is, why do you have so much of DNA? People have looked at the amount of DNA and they see that, yes, with evolution, biological complexity increasing. For example, if in animals we look at, compared to bacteria, with the fungi you have more DNA, but then mammals have much higher DNA. On an average, mammalian DNA is much more than what is in amphibia, which looks logical. Unfortunately, however, what we see is that some amoebae, which we call as a single cell simplest organism, may have 100 times more DNA than humans have. Or some amphibians may have 10 or 50 times more DNA than humans have. The question is, why so much of DNA? What does it do? Is it a function or it is just irrelevant? Britton and Davidson in 1969 did suggest that this extra DNA that we see in some organisms is probably having a regulatory role. But then this was not appreciated by everyone. And people talked about that, okay, the protein coding function, for example, in these bars, the blue region is the total genome component, this much of that, how much is protein coding region. For example, in human genomes, it's about 1.4 to 2% DNA that is supposed to be involved in protein coding. Why do we have this 98% DNA more? What does it do? Whereas if you look at lower organisms, the protein coding part is much more, but as we have evolved, we seem to have collected more and more non-protein component. Why it is this? The strangely, Orkel and Craig and several others in 1980 came out with three, four papers in Nature, back-to-back paper, talked about that this DNA is useless. And they named it variously, selfish DNA, junk DNA, and so on and so forth, and suggesting that this DNA is there without any consequence for the organs. And that's how it stayed. This concept of selfish or junk DNA had persisted even now. Although in the last one or two decades, people are forgetting more and more about the selfish or junk DNA. And actually, I would say that this concept of selfish DNA itself is becoming junk now. It was thought of earlier, but we don't believe it in now. Because we are beginning to understand this non-protein component, what it does. And that's where the non-coding RNA has become important. And so around 1970, 1980, we had the Seebeck paradox, why there's so much of nuclear DNA. And central dogma suggested that the DNA makes RNA, RNA makes protein. But then what does it do? From protein, we can't make RNA, but then why do we have so much of DNA which doesn't make anything? And so that's where they were called selfish and junk DNA. And this resulted people from discouraged researchers from working on so-called selfish and junk DNA. There was a time when funding agencies will not give money for research on some DNA that was not making protein because it was considered to be useless. But fortunately, since 1990s, there's been a reverse flow that people are getting interested and people are beginning to appreciate what the non-coding genes can do. So now we have a different variety of genes. So far we talked about genes that code for proteins, but now we talk of non-coding genes as well. Now, to put again back in the historical perspective, non-coding genes or heterochromatin, condensed chromatin, which is supposed to be not transcribed and so on, was first discovered in 1928 by German psychologist Heitz in bryophytes. And because what he could see was that some regions of chromosomes were always appeared more dark and therefore more condensed, not only in mitosis, but even during interphase. And so that's what these regions, what they call it, heterochromatin, a different kind of chromatin compared to the regions which condense at metaphase, but decondense in interphase, which you call a euchromatin or true chromatin. And the enigma of heterochromatin continued for almost six, seven decades. After Heitz's discovery, Heitz said that they are differentially condensed. Very soon it was found that they have variable proportion related species. For example, even in Drosophila, some species have 80% of the chromosome length as condensed chromatin. For example, these are Drosophila malonic acid chromosome. What we see are more dark state regions are the heterochromatic region. When we go to Drosophila viridis, almost 80% of the chromatid length will be as heterochromatin. So why should it vary so much between even related species? That was one question. And genetic studies in Drosophila particularly and other organs showed that there are very few Mendelian genes that control a phenotype directly located in heterochondric regions. Some people did claim some, but then they couldn't be established in that in early times. Now, of course, we know that there are genes within heterochondric regions which are important function. But historically, it was believed that heterochondric regions are gene deserts because they have very few Mendelian genes which can have phenotype. But it was also realized that heterochondria is essential for germline functions. That if you don't have heterochondric regions in germline, individual will sterile. And so it has some function, but what it has eluded scientists till recently. It was also known that most of the heterochondria will replicate in latest phase. This was one of the important characteristics. It was earlier believed that it was transcription inactive, but then it was shown that it's not true. I myself showed that in the Drosophila, this beta heterochondrin is transcription as active. This was shown in 1973, but then it did not secure the attention that it deserved because the general belief was that heterochondrin is inactive and therefore what is transcribing, maybe it's selfish RNA, selfish DNA or something, and therefore not cared about. But now we know that it has very great significance. Another peculiar feature of heterochondrin was that it is enriched in highly repetitive and transposable sequences. What do they do? We still do not know so much as we could have known. There's a rapid sequence divergence because repeated sequence divergence rapidly between related species. And now we understand that this rapid diversion of diversity of repeated sequences is important for reproductive isolation during speciation. Two individuals must be isolated to evolve in different lines. And heterochromatin has, in recent times, has often been viewed to condense the chromatin is that it will control transcription of transposable elements and thereby transposition, because that can be damaging to the genome. So these are various ideas that we have about heterochromatin, but we still do not know what really they do, although we have some better idea than 2-3 decades ago. The other question was, if genes are only 2% of the genome or 5% of the genome, why should there be transcription all along the genome? For example, this beautiful picture prepared in my lab by Dr. Arun Kumar Singh shows active RNA polymerase 2 on polyethylene chromosomes. And you can see certain the puff regions have enormous amount of RNA polymerase. This is a puff region. These swollen regions are puff, which are active genes. They have a lot of it. But even all along the length, we see many sites containing RNA polymerase. And of course, one can see a pink tinge all over. Even in the heterochondrin, we have these pink regions with RNA polymerase there. What it is doing? Why there's so much of transcription going on? Obviously, the transcriptome of a cell is much more complex than protein cell. And so this again raises an idea that much of this RNA must have some purpose in the body, in the cell. And so it was established in 1990s through initial studies on post-structural gene silencing, PTGS or quelling or RNA interference, as it was known in cynorhabditis later on, that these small RNAs are very important in regulating gene function. So that made people appreciate and accept that, okay, non-coding RNAs can also have function. In 1990, some long non-coding RNA, because we made two empirical differences between these non-coding RNAs, small and long. Small empirically, 100 to 200 nucleotide long. If they're smaller than that, we call them small. If they're larger than 100, 200, some people say 400, we call them long non-coding RNAs. So the actual limit is not yet clear, but small is generally believed to be less than 200 nucleotides. They are small non-coding RNA. If they're more than 200 nucleotides, we call them long non-coding RNA. But that's only a size classification, not functional classification. But one thing that we established was that the small non-coding RNAs are functional products. And what was known was that, for example, transport RNA is a small non-coding RNA, but that has been known for a long time, very important. Similarly, small nuclear RNAs have been known for a long time to be important because they will do splicing. They are part of spliceosome component. Small nuclear RNA or snow RNA, they are involved in RNA modification. during the ribosomal maturation. Then these are small Kahlberg associated RNA or scar RNA, which are involved in processing RNA, and actually recent evidence suggests that they and this small RNA may have some similar function, but some dissimilar function. Another class of small RNA is something like the silencing RNA or microRNA that are listed next, are the pi RNA or the PV protein binding RNA. These are supposed to be involved in transposon regulation, but besides regulating transposon, they may have other functions. Now, when we say that these RNAs, we must understand there are corresponding genes for making these RNAs. So we have now tRNA genes, snRNA genes, noRNA genes, scRNA genes, pi RNA genes, miRNA, silencing RNA genes, involved RNA interference. And these are one of the very large, there was thousands of genes are there that make siRNA or miRNA. And their number is continuously increasing as you look at more and more of that. When we come to long non-coding RNAs, from initial just 5 or 6 known, now we have thousands and thousands of known. Even in human genome, several thousand long non-coding RNAs are known. They have been characterized to have an important role in the disease and normal functions. And obviously, with such a variety, a large variety of nomenclature has come up. For example, some people call it sense or antisense silencing RNA. That means depending upon protein coding gene, is it in they are overlapping with protein coding gene, but they are, do they transcribe in the same orientation or different orientation, accordingly, sense or nonsense. If they are derived from intronic regions, they are called intronic RNA. Some of these intronic RNA, non-coding RNA, are stable also. Some of them turn over rapidly, but some are stable, and so accordingly, they are stable intronic sequence RNA. Then some of the promoter regions are known to transcribe. So they have been called a promoter RNA or pRNA. Then there are bidirectional non-coding RNA, that means from one start point, they are transcribed both the directions, so they have been given that kind of name. Intergenic long non-coding RNA or link RNA, which were one of the early terms given that between two genes, if some RNA is made which is non-coding, they call it intergenic link RNA. But now these terms are not really very definitive terms. They are just used as and when one likes it. Then there are mRNA-like non-coding RNAs or MLNC RNA. That means they carry intron, they carry poly A sites, but they are non-coding. So they were called as messenger RNA-like non-coding RNAs. Then there are some RNAs which can have part of them may be coding for a protein and have a function as a protein coding RNA, but a part of this RNA can function as non-coding RNA as RNA itself. So they have been called as coding and non-coding RNAs. Then there are some non-coding RNAs which are architectural. That means they provide basis for certain structures in the cell, certain organelles in the cell, which are built around these RNAs. So they have been given the name of architectural RNA. Then there are epigenetic non-coding RNAs, which are essential for epigenetic chromatin modification. There are translation non-coding RNAs, which are essential for translation of a given mRNA. These are many of the non-coding RNAs that are involved in translation function. Now, what must be understood is that these categories are not mutually exclusive, since many long non-coding RNAs are multitasking. For example, I'll talk about this. One RNA can function as architectural RNA, it can function as coding non-coding RNA, it can also function as other kinds of regulatory functions. For example, two of the long non-coding RNAs that were known in 1990s and to affect chromatin organization, one was related to the axin activation in female mammals, somatic cells of female mammals, the XIST RNA, X inactive specific transcript, so it was named as XIST. X inactive specific transcript, and it would paint or it would bind to the entire length of the X chromosome, which is inactive. Active X chromosome will not have it, only inactive X is there. And this is a huge RNA, almost 16 to 20 kilobase long RNA that does this function. Around same time in Drosophila, where dosage compensation, that the equalization of the X chromosome activity between male and female, is achieved by hyperactivation of X chromosome in male, that means male single X chromosome transcripts as much products of its genes as the two X chromosomes put together in female will do. And this was shown to be dependent upon an RNA with a non-coding RNA which binds along the entire length of this red part, the ROCKS binding, that is present all over the land. It was called ROX, RNA on X chromosome. That was the terminology name that was given. And it, so both these non-coding RNA are essential in deciding how the chromatin is organized. In this case, chromatin gets condensed, hypermethylated, histones are methylated, less of acetylation. Whereas in this case, histones are less methylated, more acetylated, so that the chromatin is loose and can transcribe at a faster rate. And so we have several examples. I'll not go into details of this. And this, of course, a very small list. Now there are thousands of such RNAs known, each RNA which is essential for regulating something else. For example, even the HOX genes, ultrabithyrox region, the different hemolytic genes, they produce many non-coding RNAs between the homeolytic genes, which are essential for transcription of the homeolytic gene themselves. And similarly, for example, there is the asexual promoter, which defines whether the zygote or dad was a male or female. There are promoter transcripts, and they regulate how the SXL protein, the mRNA, will be made. And so there are many, many examples. Y chromosome, entirely heterochromatic, considered to be typically devoid of genes, but in spermatocytes science, it makes huge transcripts, really megabase long transcripts, which are essential for spermiogenesis. Scientists are now learning to understand what these RNAs do, how do they function, what kind of regulatory roles they have. Then the architecture RNA, that means non-coding RNA that decide or organize certain membrane-less organelles. This, you see, this phenomenon of phase separation has become very important in biology today, where two molecules are together in solution, but then they get separate from each other. That's what we call as phase separation. And all membrane-less organelles, like even nucleolus, ribosomes, they are all membrane-less, but they maintain their entity integrity because of phase separation. And so all of them, it's now learned, depend on certain non-coding RNAs for their entities. For example, the splicing speckles in human or other mammalian cells, each of these is a splicing speckle, which regulates splicing process, and they have a particular RNA, MELAT1, as one of the major components. Another set of speckles in the mammalian cells is paraspeckles, which depend on another non-coding RNA called NEAT1, NEAT1, which are essential for this assembling this. In Drosophila, we discovered the HSR omega gene, which I'll talk a few minutes later, makes many RNA. One of the RNA is a long non-coding RNA, more than 10 kilobase long RNA, and which organizes these small speckles, which we named as omega speckles. This is the gene where it transcribes, this part where this gene transcribes, this RNA is present, this in situ hybridization to that RNA in the nucleus. And we can see that these omega speckles are present between chromatin, and they have very important function. And what has been now known is that these speckles, the RNA is on the periphery of these speckles. Proteins that make these speckle structure are inside. RNA is on the periphery, both the NEAT1 RNA and the paraspeckles, or the MELAT1 RNA in the splicing speckles. The green is the protein part. For example, this is SF35 immuno staining. This is RNA in situ hybridization. This is monoprotein by immuno staining. This is the NEAT1 RNA on the periphery. Similarly, omega speckles, the HNR piece, the red look to the inside, and the RNA on the outside. So what they may do is that the presence of this organelle, this RNA in the periphery, allows for multiple interactions with various proteins and various RNAs. And this is an important function that these non-coding RNAs do. This is what I was saying, that in our lab, we discovered this 93D or the HSR omega gene. In 1982, we identified as non-coding. It is conserved in different species, but is non-coding. So I think this was one of the first gene identified to be a non-coding RNA, long non-coding RNA, and it does multitasking. What we now know is that this gene, more than 21 kilobase, makes at least 7 transcripts, which are some of them are nuclear, some of them are cytoplasmic, and this long nuclear transcript is the one that organizes these omega speckles. And with these, they bind with numerous RNA binding proteins, and thereby regulate functions of many other activities in the cell. For example, this is what we have been able to show, that these nuclear transcripts can sense the intracellular and extracellular signals and then can regulate chromatin oxidation through interaction with these different proteins, RNA expression, splicing, trafficking, through interaction with these different group of proteins, nuclear matrix, RNA transport, through interaction with these other proteins. They can interact with several molecular chaperones, and thereby HSP83, HSP70 can modulate multiple functions in the cell. They interact with RAS also. They interact with the cell death pathway, and thereby they can decide whether the cell will survive or cell will die. And that's what we see. One single non-coding RNA can do so many functions. And that's where one has to now think of non-coding RNAs as hubs in cellular networks. And this is just one example. And now we are beginning to understand hundreds of such examples where same RNA is involved in multitasking activities. And so what we now begin to understand is something that was ignored as junk or selfish had now become the master regulators of epigenotype. I've written several reviews on this, and of course many other reviews have come out in the last 10 years. There were thousands of reviews on these non-coding RNAs, small and long. And the thing keep on increasing. This particular article centered on self-made DNA non-coding RNA. I've tried to look at historically how the idea of self-made DNA came in, how misinterpretation happened, and how non-coding RNAs were ignored for quite some time. But now it's good that we are beginning to understand this. So a focus on a protein coding gene is grossly inadequate. We need to fully understand the non-coding components, which account for larger parts of the diverse genome. Because as I showed earlier, that in humans, less than 2% of the DNA is only coding for proteins. What the remaining 98% does is need to be understood. And what is important was to appreciate is, way back in 1980s and 90s, it was known that the difference between humans and chimpanzees is not in protein coding genes, but in the remaining 98% DNA. I mean, only less than 1% DNA sequence difference, but that was mostly in the non-coding region. So obviously, it's the non-coding components that decide what an organ will do and what it will not do, because they are important for generation and maintenance of the complex regulatory networks required for eukaryotic complexity. And therefore, we must appreciate the enormous diversity of biological systems. This needs equally diverse information and regulatory circuits. Because each organ is, we study about model organs, but then let's not forget that in nature, organs live in their own ways, in their own, so all of them don't follow the rules that we discover in model organs. They're very diverse ways of doing their things. And the more we look at it, more we will understand that we'll get to the diversity. As of now, we know only a fraction of the diversity because we have not studied them. We have not looked at the life cycle, their development, their phenotypes, and the genotypes. As you know more, obviously things are becoming more and more puzzling, but more exciting. You see, this is like when if you ask me what is a gene, this simile of elephants and blind men comes to my mind. Each one looks at one part and says, this is how gene is. And this is what the historical narrative that I have carried on has described. Each one has described different parts. And we need to look at the comprehensive picture. Otherwise, we'll define a gene depending on what one looks at. And that's really not enough. Continuous studies are bound to unravel more variables to what makes a gene. And this is an exciting challenge for future research in biology. You see, it should not be depressing that we can never define a gene. It is much more a challenge that, all right, what are features of a gene we can discover, which makes all the living systems as they are. And this is a great challenge for coming years to understand what is a gene. Maybe we may not be able to define a gene. We can describe gene just as we cannot define an elephant, we can describe an elephant. But instead of defining parts of an elephant, we will soon, I'm sure, be able to define the entire gene, its entirety. Thanks. I'll stop there and we'll be happy to take questions.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are.
Sir, recently I was reading a review on what is gene and its evolution, and there was a one definition proposed in 2017 by Portin and Wilkins. It says that a gene is a DNA sequence whose component system do not necessarily need to be physically contiguous, that specifies one or more sequence related RNAs, proteins that are both evoked by gene regulatory networks and participate as elements in gene regulatory networks after with indirect effect or as outputs of gene regulatory networks that later yield more direct phenotypic effects. Sir, what do you think about this definition?
The definition will have many, many components, many, many variables, because first of all, RNA viruses have their own genes, so it's not necessarily DNA. We talk of DNA because most of the organs have DNA, but so, all right, that's one. But then people talk of enhancer sequence. Now, one may call it enhancer gene, because we do talk about suppressor genes and enhancer genes, which work for the long distance. Whether they work by physical association, by looping of the DNA, chromatin from different chromosomes coming together in a physical space. So there cannot be any one way that everything will do. In some cases, the enhancer may be nearby. In some cases, the enhancer may be on a different chromosome altogether. So they're variable. So I believe that it's not possible to give a single definition that describes everything that a gene can be organized in, gene can function in different ways, and therefore any single definition will always have many qualifications that this is applicable in this case but not in another case.
Sir, one more thing. Sir, yes. Can we safely say that for example, a phenotype, say X, is being observed, that phenotype is a result of a genetic network, and gene is a component of that genetic network that ultimately is resulting into a phenotype?
True, that's true. A gene, but it may not be a single gene. It will be network that gives a phenotype. In that sense, see, Mendel's definition of factor controlling a phenotype is a very simple, but maybe we have to talk in that sense, because when you talk of factor, we are also imagining there are interactions. Just one gene cannot, or its isolation, give a phenotype. Phenotype is an end result of multiple gene activities, interactions, modifications, regulations, and so on. So for example, to talk of white eye in the soft light, not just that a gene makes an eye directly white eye. Gene makes one product, which may or may not do a function.
Right, sir. Sir, we cannot have a one-to-one-to-one equation. Like,
yeah. Yes,
Sir, that is well established, sir. Thank you, sir. One more thing, sir. Can we establish a DNA to RNA one-to-one equation? Yeah, or is that also vague?
What do you mean by one-to-one equation?
Sir, like in Central Dogma, it was 1:1:1 for DNA to RNA to protein.
Well,
so can we say
a segment of DNA can make multiple RNAs also by processing? But more important, it can also do is that sometimes in the transcription, the RNA polymerase can jump from one place to another and skip some regions. These are rare cases, but that can happen. The point is that whether every RNA that is made will have a function, we still do not know. Some RNA made just as part of the regulatory process or part of something else, but these are questions that need to be looked into.
Okay, sir. Got it, sir. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, you talked about how organelles can differentiate itself from cytoplasm by liquid-liquid phase separation by interaction of LNC RNAs and intrinsically disordered domains of the proteins. So how actually this long non-coding RNAs act for this phenomenon? So what is the function there? Do they act only as scaffolding or something else?
Well, they will do both. You see, they may be scaffolds, but they may also, because of their particular structure, bring in the protein which disordered domains or complete domain to come in a particular form to make a lattice which becomes spontaneously phase separated. So it's not that it's a step-by-step process. You put them in and suddenly you find there's phase separation. So it's the process of interaction between the RNA, because see why we implicate RNAs? If we remove RNA, this phase separation for that particular organelle doesn't take place. If you remove NAT1 RNA, paraspectral don't exist, all of the proteins are there. But NAT1 RNA is not there, that paraspectral doesn't form. Similarly, omega spectrums, we remove the HS omega RNA, all the proteins are there, but spectrums are not there. Same way, some proteins we remove, RNA is there. So it's the interaction that will decide when and where, under what condition phase separation will take place.
Okay, so it's like universal for all the membraneless organelles, right?
Well, all the membraneless organelles are based on phase separation.
Okay. So, okay. Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, you mentioned about the CNC RNAs, the coding non-coding RNAs, where you said that they might either function as mRNAs or LNC RNAs. So, sir, my question is, what are the cellular factors which governs such a multitasking feature? I mean, what determines the fate of such RNAs within a cell?
Well, you see, it may so happen that you have multiple molecules of that RNA. I'm just putting a scenario that some of the molecules that are translated make a protein. Other RNA molecules bind with certain other proteins and they will modulate their function. They may not get translated. So, they can do both, or they may be cleaved so that one part codes for a protein, another part, for example, introns. If introns are removed, we generally think that introns are removed and thrown out, but that doesn't happen. Many introns stay on and do their function in certain ways. Even in a typical messenger RNA, we have 5' UTR, 3' UTR, untranslated regions on the upstream of the translation start point and downstream of the translation termination point. Now, these are not the sequences. They have very important roles. They bind to certain proteins, and thereby they can either prevent or facilitate translation. They can cause, for example, 3' UTR will decide how long an mRNA will survive. So that's not a function through translation, not making protein, but by the RNA binding certain proteins, that decides whether this protein will go for RNA turnover or will remain stable. And so this is what we have to understand.
Okay, sir.
Sir, there is one more question written in chat box. Am I audible to you, sir?
Sure, but there's some noise. I think others should keep their mics off so that there's no echo or noise coming in.
Yes, I think most of the, okay, sir, I will re-request with them. So the question is, in Drosophila, 80% are heterochromatin and 20% are euchromatin, or either less. So even research are ongoing on this about heterochromatin and euchromatin. So any comments on that? This is question by Karthik K. Raj.
Well, you see, all Drosophila do not have 80% heterochromatin. I just mentioned Drosophila viridis. One particular species has so much of heterochromatin. Other species also have. So there's a variable amount. Now, and this is the question of C. mellifera. Why should it vary? What it is, we still do not know why they should carry so much of extra DNA or less DNA. That is something we still will have to study. Actually, in nature, you see what happens, one of the limitations that we have is most of the experimental studies are in lab under ideal conditions of, see, for example, Drosophila maintain at precise 24 degrees centigrade, certain humidity levels, but that doesn't happen in nature. Each species lives in a different, even in same geographical area, has a different ecological niche. So it may need certain subtle variabilities to maintain itself, and that's where some of these heterochromatic sequences, non-coding sequences may be playing an important role. We still do not know that. Okay, any other question?
Yes, sir, there is one more. So Harini is asking, sir, because we consider gene as an information carrying fragment, so in case of RNA viruses, can we consider their RNA as a gene?
Of course. Their genetic material is RNA, and we do talk of genes in them also. Each are making different protein.
Yes. Any other questions from MSc students? There's one more question, sir. Is charges in phenotype is also due to change? Sorry, is change in phenotype is also due to the change in enzyme modification?
Well, yes. You see, change in phenotype can happen for two different reasons. One may be the DNA sequence changes. That's what we call genetic change. And the other is the modification of the chromatin, either by modification of the DNA, like methylation and so on and so forth, or modification of the associated proteins. What kind of proteins are associated with the DNA and the chromatin, whether they are modified, they are epigenetically modified. So that's what we call as epigenetic changes, where the DNA sequence is not changed, but the expression of the phenotype changes because of how, where, and how long, and how much that DNA is able to transcribe or not able to transcribe. So the change in phenotype is actually that's where you see the classical term phenotype itself says genotype plus environment makes a phenotype. And now we know that this phenotype includes epigenetic changes as well.
Sir, I have a question, sir. Sir, can you explain the concept of gene sharing and what it implies in terms?
I'm not clear what you mean by gene sharing.
Sir, there was a concept that says ki gene may acquire and maintain a second function without gene duplication and without loss of primary function. Such genes are under two or more entirely different selection constraints. This was done in 1989 by...
Yes, I can understand it now. Well, you see, I said they are overlapping genes, where there are two different genes making very different products in more than two different conditions present in the same DNA sequence. So there will be obviously certain evolutionary restraints on each one of them, how much they can change without affecting the other one. But each one can evolve independently also to some extent. So these we can call as gene sharing. The two genes are overlapping completely or partially, and therefore they share the same sequence, but then maintain their different functions, and therefore their different selective advantages and disadvantages of mutation that can happen.
Okay.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Karthike, sir. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Sir, there is one question which always arises in my mind, sir. That many of the diseases which are due to the protein interaction, sir, like if the cancer is just occurring, I am BSc second year student, sir. So yeah. If any diseases, yeah. Cancer is occurring, so anti-cancerous type of protein is occurring. This is produced and this could be detected by testing with the antibody, any type of antibody is interacting. So sometimes, sir, different type of RNA, they are also creating the different type of problem diseases. So, sir, as far as in the book, sir, it is mentioned that protein could be detected. But, sir, in the case of the RNA, sir, so how we will just detect the RNA, sir? And there is one question, sir, that in the proteomics that we are working on the making the microchips for detection of the different type of diseases in the only one sample, sir. So how to just synthesize such type of techniques, sir, that we could predict the RNA that will resolve all the problem from a single test and through which the patient, they will not suffer much of the rupees, sir, on the test.
Okay.
Explain,
okay.
Sir, please.
First thing, all problems will not be solved because as we learn more about it, you see, initially we knew what oncogenes and proto-oncogenes, that one of them is involved in this cancer or that cancer. But now, as we understand more and more, there are numerous microRNAs, long non-coding RNAs, and other proteins, and other changes in the promoter region or somewhere in the intron region that are also associated with the cancer. And therefore, the diagnosis on one hand becomes easy, but on the other hand at the same time becomes more complicated. But then coming to your question that how to detect a change in RNA, RT-PCR is one simple way, but provided we know which RNA is a marker. And actually in recent years, a large number of, a major part of the studies on non-coding RNAs are geared to identify markers for different diseases. That in which disease, which microRNA or long non-coding RNA becomes more prevalent or disappears or gets modified in some way. And if you can detect them by using specific chips, you see there are biosensors being developed by people that you can develop a biosensor that will detect the presence of a given RNA or a given protein, or one can do reverse transcription PCR. So either of these techniques, but then none of them can be 100% sure. This we must understand, because a same disease is a phenotype, and same phenotype can result from multiple genetic, epigenetic processes. And therefore, one answer cannot satisfy every question in this case.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, there is one more student question. He is asking whether we can grow a DNA sequence using a protein particle.
We can. Well, see, what we know is a protein, the protein that binds with DNA binds at a short sequence, often 5, 6, 8, 10 base long sequence only. So all that we can know is that if this protein is bound to DNA, there must be that signature of the DNA binding site. That's what we can do. We can't describe the entire DNA sequence. That we can do either indirectly by bioinformatics study that we know in another species, a cell protein binds to this particular DNA sequence, and if this binds to this sequence in this organ, it should have a similar sequence, but that's all. We can't do DNA sequencing by simple protein binding assay. No, I don't think so.
There is one more question. Sir, if you allow us, can we still continue this discussion with the student?
Yeah, you can have about 10-15 more minutes if you want. If there are questions.
Thank you so much, sir. So, because this is a discussion class, like with the MSc people, Pooja, can you describe how the mutational load related to C-value paradox?
Well, you see, that has been one idea have been floated, that we have, why we have so much of DNA. That if mutations are random, any base can change. And a mutation is usually harmful. So one of the idea was that if you have much more DNA, maybe mutations will happen in something that is not essential. But that view, I think, was accepted or proposed when people did not know that the non-coding component also has so many functions. What we now know is in non-coding RNA, many mutations are tolerated. They don't affect, because as long as for non-coding RNA, what is important for its function is the structure that it can attain because of intramolecular bondings. That's one part. So if it can maintain same structure while other regions are varying in the sequence, it doesn't matter. For example, if you take NEAT1 RNA in humans, in mouse and rat, and there's a lot of sequence variation, but still in all of them, it has same secondary tertiary structure and same function. So in such cases, random mutations at the non-essential part can be tolerated. And so that is where the idea came, that if you have more DNA, then it can act as a buffer against spontaneous mutation or random mutations, because many of the mutations will not be immediately affecting a functional region. But now we are not sure whether that can always be valid. One will have to experiment and look at it, that in species which have much more DNA and relative species which have less DNA, how does this load work on? I think some of those early studies that were done need to be revisited again with the modern knowledge that we have.
One last question, sir. The student is asking, is there any role of gene in controlling human behavior? If any role, then why twins show different behavior?
Well, again, it's not a one-to-one behavior that one gene will make you angry and one gene make you happy. You see, these are very relative things. We do know that there are genes that control behavior. I may incidentally say, then a fruit fly can get angry, can fight. it also has similar genes that humans have. So that it has many genes that control emotion, that control behavior. So behavior has a genetic component, but behavior is also, a lot of it depends on our own experiences, particularly in humans, which are long learning experience, long behavior, and therefore the way we will respond to a given condition depends on the previous experiences, and that may not be entirely genetic. It may be more to do with epigenetic changes. And therefore, to say that genes are independent of genes, behavior is independent of genes, is not correct. Behavior is dependent only on genes is also not correct. Actually, nothing can be all or none in biology. There are always interacting networks that we must think of.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really a great lecture by you, and definitely fulfilled what we thought of putting this lecture for MSc students. It was purely commendable thing, like we have done this, and people, students has put this discussion part truly as an MSc class. I'm very honored to be with you, sir, with this lecture. I would like to invite Dr. Sabyasachi, sir, Sabyasachi Sengupta, sir, to propose a vote of thanks.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you, Lakotia, sir. So I have listened to your talk. I think this is fifth talk. Mm-hmm. And even in this point of time, I'm thrilled to listen to you about basics of genetics, human genetics or genetics as a whole. So I listened to you first time when I was in BSc, I went to BHU. Then I listened to you in the Cell Biology Conference 2007, Delhi University, as a MSc student with Zoology Department. Then I listened to you in the Department of Genetics when Dr. Sarkar joined in 2007-8. Mm-hmm. And then I listened to you 2011 and today. So, still your talks are very, interesting. These are very important for students as well as even for the faculties who want to know the history of genetics as a whole. So thank you, sir, for your effort and for your talk. This department is very young, established in 2013, and presently there are six faculties. The senior most faculty is Professor Anjana Munshi, Professor and Dean Research. Then Dr. J.S. Bhatti, you have already met him as HOD. Then Dr. Sandeep Singh, myself, Dr. Preeti Khetrapal, and Dr. Narendra, the youngest faculty in the department, who invited you for this beautiful talk. Thank you again, sir, for explaining what is gene, what are the transcription, what are the different function of a gene, and how to say how many genes are there. So you are correct that even till date, we do not know how many genes are present in human genome. So whatever people have found earlier in Drosophila, that non-coding genome are present, there are genes in two opposite strand of a same DNA, same locus. After even 1,000 genome sequence, these things become true and we can look at it. We visually, experimentally, we can quantify, we can see the effect of genes which are present in the same locus. So when I listened to you in 2007, I was thrilled to understand what is non-coding genome. So thank you, sir, because I wrote two projects in UGC and CERB, and in two projects I tried to investigate the role of non-coding RNA in celiac disease. It's a gastrointestinal condition, which is known as gluten sensitivity.
Yeah.
So even today's talk was beautiful when I got to know some new insight into this concept, because some of your slides are very new. I think last 4 or 5 slides are new in your talk.
Most of the slides are very new, made for
Last time.
Did do that, this activity.
Yes. Because some of your talks are basically experimental, where you show lot of immunofluorescent pictures or Drosophila eye, brain structure, and for neurons and etc. And this talk, I have listened to this talk, I think, in 2011. So thank you, sir, for your time, for your generous effort to make students understand what are genes, what are locus, what are the unit of genetic unit, and etc. That will surely help our student to know more in our regular classes. Because due to this pandemic condition, we could not invite you by person. But you know, once this thing will go and in 2021, maybe sometime we'll invite you. And I'm sure that you will be coming here to grace the occasion and interact with the students like we did. So we interacted with you when we were in MSc and BSc classes. So that was very motivating for us. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your nice talk.
Thank you all. Yeah. Okay, bye.
Thank you so much, sir.